Good morning, Resurrection people. What a blizzardy Sunday. Oh my goodness. I have to tell you, I am not one to do live video. It took a blizzard last year to go for our first time live on a Sunday morning, and I was glad Pastor Lee did it. It had to be pretty bad out for me to agree to do live video, but here we are. So with the Weather Service issuing a blizzard warning today, we thought we should heed those authorities, and when they say no travel recommended, that we would just do what they ask us to do and keep people safe. If we're able to put this message out online and still get the gospel and the scriptures to you this way, then we are happy to do that. We're just going to wait for some people to log on. We want to get started here about 10 o'clock, but I would invite you to grab your Bibles. We're going to be digging through 1 Corinthians 6 today, and so open your Bibles, get those ready, 1 Corinthians, because we're going to be digging through those verses line by line. Maybe you got a chance to look at the YouTube songs that we had put together, that playlist that we sent out in the email last night. Hopefully you've had a chance to do a little bit of worship before you gathered here. If not, we will link that worship set in the comments, and at the end of the message, at the end of our time together today, you'll be able to go back and end your time with us in worship. So it's getting a little bit after 10 o'clock, it looks like. And so, again, welcome to everyone. I'm Pastor Jedediah with the blizzard warning. We thought we better do things safe. If we can still get the message out, we'll do it the best way we can that way. So through YouTube and whatnot. Just a word to parents that are out there this morning. Typically when we gather together as the community, our pre-K to fifth grade are down the Sunday school halls, and they're in their Sunday school classes getting age-appropriate type of instruction and gospel and word from Jesus. They pray together and sit together. And so usually when we get together in the larger group, it's sixth grade up and the adults. And so I just wanted to give you just a disclaimer, if you will, that today is probably PG-13, coming out of 1 Corinthians 6. So I have my 12-year-old daughter here, and she will probably have some questions after this. But if you have 6, 7, 8-year-olds, they may have more questions than you were ready to deal with today. Just with the content as we work through 1 Corinthians 6. But here's where we're going. We're going to start with a word of prayer. I'm going to open the scriptures for us, and then we will unpack that message. We'll take some time in prayer. Andrea is going to lead us in prayer. At that point, you can put in whatever prayer requests you have in the comments, and we'll pray for those. And then we'll be able to give an offering. We can text to give or get online to give. So we'll close our time with an offering and a benediction. Great to see everyone who has joined us on Facebook Live. Thanks for being here. We're going to get started with a word of prayer. Now that we're a little after 10, we'll get started. Hopefully you have your Bible with us because we're going to be digging in here shortly. Let's pray. Hey, Lord, thank you for our time together. Thank you for a weather service who is watching out for us and trying to give us the best information that they have. We are grateful that we have the ability through this wonderful technology of the internet to share the gospel. And so, Lord, we ask that your name be glorified today. We ask that your word be revealed today. We ask that your spirit reach through these screens and touch each one of us. Bring us together as your church. In Jesus' name, amen. That's one thing that's hard about internet stuff is you miss the face-to-face and the handshakes and the hugs. And I'd much rather be in the church building, gathering with the church to hug and handshake each of you. But this will have to do for this Sunday. Let's dig into 1 Corinthians 6, if you have your Bibles with you. Hopefully you have a bookmark there. I am reading from the New International Version on my computer, and hopefully you have it in front of you as well. 1 Corinthians 6, we are starting in verse 12. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 12. Paul's writing to the Corinthians, and he says in verse 12, "I have the right to do anything, you say, but not everything is beneficial. I have the right to do anything, but I will not be mastered by anything. You say, food is for the stomach, and the stomach for food, and God will destroy them both. The body, however, is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. By his power, God raised the Lord from the dead, and he will raise us also. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? Shall I then take the member of Christ and unite it with a prostitute? Never. Do you not know that he who unites himself with a prostitute is one with her in body? For it is said, the two will become one flesh. But whoever is united with the Lord is one with him in spirit. Flee from sexual immorality. All other sins a person commits are outside the body, but whoever sins sexually sins against their own body. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies." Hey, welcome to everyone who's here this morning watching. We have, it looks like 68 people that have joined us. And that's just 68, 70 people who have joined us. And we don't even know how many people are logged in on the other side watching on that screen. If you'd be so kind to just put the number of people that are sitting with you, that'd be super great. We'd be able to see if this is even an effective way to reach you when we're in a blizzard like this. Hopefully we don't have to do it more often, but let us know how many people are watching with you. That'd be great. I'm going to unpack 1 Corinthians 6, 12 through 20 this morning. And Paul always greeted his churches. Even in his letters, maybe he would have through the internet by saying, "Grace and peace to you from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior Jesus, who is the Christ. Amen." He said, "Mom, everyone's doing it." And then Dad stepped in and said, "You mean to tell me, son, if everyone was jumping off a bridge, you would too?" You know the conversation, don't you? You've probably had that conversation, asked that rhetorical question to any of your kids if they were ever in middle school. You know, I think that I had that very conversation with my parents back when I lived in Winona, and we were jumping off the trestle bridges into the Mississippi River one summer. And so in that conversation, I actually got to answer yes. You know, if everyone was jumping off a bridge, I would too, Dad. Yes. My dad was not very pleased. And I look back now and I realize, number one, you're not supposed to answer rhetorical questions. Number two, jumping off a bridge into the backwaters of the Mississippi is a seriously dangerous thing to do. And number three, it actually is illegal. But Mom, everyone's doing it. You know, many of us, even as we grow older, make that argument with ourselves. Everyone is doing it, and some of it isn't even illegal. You know, we live in a country of great freedoms. We have the freedom to do a lot of things that are not illegal, but at the same time, they're not always beneficial or helpful. And yet, we make that argument. Everyone else is doing it. Why shouldn't I? You know, that's the sentiment in our text this morning. We're in 1 Corinthians 6. We've been working through this letter since the beginning of the year, and so if you want to follow along, I'd invite you to open your Bibles. I'm working out of the NIV Bible. Open to 1 Corinthians 6 and follow along. I don't have a page number for you. Typically, we have black pew Bibles, but if you're in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, 1 and 2 Corinthians, or there's a table of contents. That'll have the page number too. So check out 1 Corinthians chapter 6 is where we're going to be. And as you find that, let me tell you, the Apostle Paul has brought the good news of Jesus to this city of Corinth. The gospel, that's the Greek word for good news. And he's preached this good news until some people in that community have started to believe. And they've started to gather as a church, as the family of God. And they have created this community. Part of the message that Paul was preaching, part of the message of the gospel, is that Christians are free from the law. That we're free from the law that tells us we have to do this or we can't do that. But then there's the other half of the gospel, in that Jesus, although he sets us free from the law, he gives us a new commandment to love. A new law to love one another as he loved us. And it's not a law that is self-serving. It is a self-sacrificial love that puts the other person first. Actually, Martin Luther called it the freedom of the Christian is perfectly free, Lord of all, subject to none. And the Christian is perfectly dutiful, servant of all, subject to all. You know, it's both halves of the gospel when you say it like that. But those seem to be contradictory statements, that we're free Lord of all, subject to none, yet at the same time dutiful servant of all, subject to all. See, the problem is that we don't like living in paradox very well. We don't like doing both halves. We want either or. We want to have freedom from all in the law, but not be subject to all in love. And in an either-or kind of world, the Corinthians have grabbed on to the first half of the gospel without grasping the second half. I have the right to do anything, they say in verse 12. I mean, that phrase seemed to be a mantra in the Corinthian church. I have the right to do anything. And yes, that's part of the gospel, and Paul did preach that to them. Because love, that second half, really has no limits. You can do anything in love. To love the neighbor doesn't just mean don't steal from them, don't kill them, don't bear false witness against them. That's just the low bar. That's the minimum requirement. Don't kill them. The law of love has no bounds. You can do anything. It gives you the ability to visit them when they're sick, to check in on them during a blizzard like this, to feed them when they're hungry, to give them shelter when they're homeless, to invite them over and befriend them when they're lonely and comfort them when they grieve. I mean, you really can't go too far in love. You really can't overserve in love. You really can't sacrifice too much when you're going to follow Jesus' law of love. So yes, I have the right to do anything. But Paul reminds us, not everything is beneficial. Not everything is helpful. So the question for a Christian shouldn't be, is it legal? Of course. We're required to live by the civil laws of the government. The question for a Christian should be, even if it is legal, is it beneficial? Is it helpful? Does it do love to the neighbor or does it only serve me? In so many cases, we have to restrain ourselves from simply doing what is legal so that we can do what is loving. That's Paul's whole point in the first half of this chapter about bringing lawsuits against one another. You know, we heard about that last week. It certainly was legal to sue one another, but Paul says you do it just to bring hurt. You do it just to pay back wrong. It's legal, but it's not loving. Your mother would say two wrongs don't make a right, even if it is legal. You know, in the second half of chapter 6, Paul's now talking about sexual immorality, about this this immorality that was legal, but it wasn't beneficial, it wasn't helpful, it wasn't loving. If you remember, just the context, Corinth is a big city. It's filled with lots of sexual immorality as God defines it, but none of it is illegal as the culture defines it. You know, it's not a whole lot different than the America we live in today. And even where sexual immorality is illegal in the American justice system, it's almost never prosecuted. And so, like Corinth, American sensibilities allow sex as recreation between two consenting adults. And that sounds crass, but it is the accepted storyline. We see it in our movies, in our sitcoms. You see it all over social media in America where, yeah, mom, everyone is doing it. You know, that's where we live today. I was recently talking with a young man who was upset with some of his friends. He was appalled that it had become commonplace, almost a game, to see how many married people these young men had been fooling around with. I mean, it was like a competition for them that got bragging rights. And man, I'm not often surprised when I'm talking with people, but I think he saw my mouth hang wide open. I mean, I knew we were in trouble with the permissiveness of sexual immorality in America today, but I had never heard of that before. You see, in Corinth, it wasn't illegal to have sexual relations with temple prostitutes. I mean, as strange as that may sound to us, it was normal. It was a normal part of the pantheon of religions. That's what people did. That was the regular part of the worship practice of those who bowed down at the Greek gods of Aphrodite and Dionysus. You know, before the gospel came to Corinth, if you worshiped the gods, that's what you did. It was perfectly legal. But what we have to remember is that Paul is not writing this letter to the city of Corinth. He's not writing to everyone who lives there. He's writing it to the church of Corinth. He's writing to the 150 men and women who have committed their lives to following Jesus into the kingdom of God. I mean, that's what he says at the very opening of this letter in chapter 1. Paul makes it clear that he's writing to instruct the Christians. He's writing to the church of God in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus and called to be his holy people, he says. He's not writing to the culture of Corinth in the first century or the culture of America in the 21st century. He's writing to Christians, to those who call themselves followers of Jesus, to those who are in the church. You know, in the middle of chapter 6, Paul says, "Do not be deceived," verse 9. "Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who have sex with men, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God." And that's what some of you were. But you were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. Paul says you don't live there anymore. But everyone is doing it. And Paul turns around and says, yeah, but not in this house, not in this family. We're not going to live like everyone else. We've been transferred into the kingdom of God, and we no longer live in the kingdom of the world. It's different to live as followers of Jesus. Your sin was washed away. You're set apart as holy. It's okay to not do what everyone else is doing. You know, sometimes I think that we tend to think that it's just about what we believe in our soul that makes us a follower of Jesus, just by what's in our hearts and in our minds. But let me tell you, it's not just about our souls and our spirit that are holy and good. But God says our bodies are good as well. In faith, in Christianity, the body and the soul are not separated. God claims the whole being. The body, however, is not meant for sexual immorality, Paul says in verse 13. The body is for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. God loves our bodies. Listen to this. God loves our bodies so much that he's going to raise them from the dead. That's what he says in verse 14. By his power, God raised the Lord from the dead, and he will raise us also. Jesus was born in a body, lived in a body, died in a body, and when he rose from the dead, he rose in a body. He's just like us. Our bodies are good. Our sexuality is good. God not only likes him, but he inhabits them. God made our bodies, and he will eventually save and redeem them. And so our bodies and our sexuality belong to God. And the gift of our bodies are to be used for what they were meant for. The place for God to dwell. The location of the divine on earth. The temple of God's Holy Spirit. It's in our physical bodies. If you jump down to verse 19, Paul says, "Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies." I mean, those are amazing verses. If you want to underline anything in your text today, underline this, verses 19 and 20. Our bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit. God resides in us, not in some church building over there or some temple someplace far off, but God dwells in us. And as you underline that, those two verses and all of the promises and the truth that are contained there, I want you to realize that this is probably also the hardest thing for us to hear. Because Paul says, you are not your own. You know, many of us think that we have the right to do whatever we want with our bodies. I mean, it's our body. We can use it, treat it, deal with it the way that we desire. But Paul says, no, you are not your own. As a Christian, we don't own our own bodies. They belong to God. And so what we do with our bodies must honor God. What God bought with the blood of his son Jesus is what he will raise from the dead. Not just our souls, our hearts, or our minds, but our bodies as well. So Paul says in verse 15, "Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself?" You see, everywhere you go, everything you do, everyone you interact with, Jesus interacts with. Because he lives in our bodies, and our bodies are part of his. And so Paul is going to deal with now how we use our bodies in chapter 6, how we use our bodies sexually. Again, in verse 15, he says, "Shall I then take the members of Christ and unite them with a prostitute?" Never, Paul says. You know, just from a religious standpoint, to unite with a temple prostitute unites with the deity of that prostitute. So then, you're committing adultery against God's body. But let me just bring it down to the 21st century for Christians. Because what I think is most instructive, living in America today, trying to follow Jesus, is verse 16. And I know I've been kind of circling around this verse all morning, but that's where the bullseye is. This is the takeaway. Verse 16 says, "Do you not know that he who unites himself with a prostitute is one with her in body? For it is said, the two will become one flesh." Listen, Paul is talking about the spiritual reality of marriage. Genesis 2 says, "That's why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh." I mean, that is what God declares in the Garden of Eden between Adam and Eve when God creates marriage, when he forms the family. When we unite our bodies sexually with another person, we are doing what the Bible calls marriage. We're creating a physical, spiritual, and emotional bond that makes us one flesh with that person. Whether we acknowledge that or not, sexual relationships are not just casual or recreational. They actually create one flesh. We become spiritually, emotionally, and physically enfleshed with that person. And see, that's why cheating and adultery in any relationship is devastating. Marriages crumble, engagements end, breakups occur because all of a sudden that oneness is ripped apart. But that's why it hurts so bad. Because the flesh is ripped apart and we're left there standing with a deep wound. Right? We say things like, that broke my heart. We feel like we're bleeding inside. He just tore me up. She just tore me apart. And that's what has happened. That's what has really gone on. We've been ripped apart from that other person. And I've talked to too many people who have suffered this wound themselves. And what we fail to understand is that when we share our bodies sexually, even in multiple long-term dating relationships, is that we create marriages and divorces over and over again, regardless of any signed marriage certificate here on earth. We're wounding ourselves. When that relationship is over, we experience many of the same feelings, many of the same fallouts that divorced people experience. Anxiety, depression, sadness, a deep sense of loss and brokenness, a lower self-esteem, honestly, a wounded spirit. So sure, everyone is doing it, but not everything is beneficial. So now what? Is there any good news in this? Well, maybe you've suffered that wound. Maybe you've been hurt. Your heart's been broken and ripped apart. You've been deeply wounded. Yes. Is there a way forward? Absolutely. Is there a way that you're so ruined that you can't belong in God's family? Are you too messed up to be a part of the family of faith? By no means. There is forgiveness. And right from the lips of Jesus. If you remember the woman caught in adultery in John 8, a woman is brought before the religious leaders and Jesus is there and they want him to condemn her. She and her partner were caught having an affair. But Jesus reminds all of the accusers that there is no one without sin. He says, those without sin cast the first stone. And by the time he stands up and looks around, there's no one left. They're all gone. And Jesus says to the woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you? Then neither do I condemn you. Go now and leave your life a sin. Listen, Jesus doesn't condemn you. He doesn't shame you. He doesn't judge you. He doesn't kick you out of the family. He forgives you. He extends mercy. He offers grace and he turns you around to live a life away from sin, no longer caught in brokenness and wounding. He doesn't want you to live like that anymore. He doesn't do what is legal. He does what is loving. He loves you too much to let you keep wounding your own heart. So he gives you the freedom to live differently in his kingdom, where you're loved, respected, and cared for, body and soul. And yes, it may take time to heal. Wounds take time to heal. And it'll take God's love to scar over those wounds and to put your heart back together again. But he did it for the woman who was dragged in front of him, and he can do it for the men and women who come before him today. Paul says, that is what some of you were in the past, before you knew Jesus, but now. Those are the key words, but now you've been washed. You've been sanctified. You've been justified by God. In this family of God, every one of us has scars that have been healed. In this kingdom of God, every one of us has had our bleeding hearts put back together again. In this household of God, every one of us has been forgiven and turn toward a new life. And you belong in this family. You belong in this kingdom. And you belong in this household of God. You can believe that. And you can hold on to that truth today tighter than any accusing message running through your head. You are not too broken to heal. You are not too far gone to come home. You are not too ruined to be restored. Why? Because you are not your own. You were bought at a price. You belong to God, and He loves you more than you can imagine. Come to Him and let Him heal you, because you can't honor God with your body. Amen. We're going to enter into a time of prayer. Andrea is going to lead us. If you have something of concern on your heart or something of thanksgiving, certainly would love you to put that in the comments, and she will lead us in a time of prayer. So anything that you want us to pray for, go ahead and put in the comments, and we'll lift those up.
Good morning, Resurrection. It's good to be with you here through the incredible power of the internet here. So if you would, please close your eyes, bow your head, and join me in a time of prayer. Good and gracious Lord, we give thanks today for who you are and just the great love that you have for us. Lord, we can enter into these hard texts and reflect on these hard words and let these words sink into our heart because we know who you are. We know the character of your heart and the great love that you have for us. And it's a love that does not want to leave us there. And so, Lord, we just praise you for your love, for your grace, for your mercy that is fresh and new every day. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Today, though, as we read over these words, the scripture, we know that some of that hits deep within our heart and within our spirit. And so, Lord, in this time, we take this time to acknowledge that there have been many times we have followed the ways of the world instead of the ways of your word, Lord, and we ask for forgiveness. Lord, we know that we haven't treated our body as the temple that you have created it to be. Lord, we seek your forgiveness. And Lord, we might have things that we need to confess right now, specific sexual sin that has just been weighing us down over the days, the weeks, the years. Lord, we seek you now and we come to you, Lord, to lay those heavy burdens down at the cross and know that you take them up and you will take them away. So Lord, we just take this moment to lay down any sexual immorality, any sexual sin that we have carried with us, again, in the previous days, weeks, years. We lay that down, Lord, before your cross. Thank you, Lord, that we can come to you in these hard times, in these hard texts, and that word can wash over us and it can change us and transform us. Thank you, Lord. Again, that just speaks to who you are and the love and the kindness that you have towards us. Today, Lord, we have some specific requests and things that we are praying for. Lord, we give thanks for the first responders that we have. We give thanks for the firefighters. We give thanks for the sheriffs and the police officers, the medical responders that are all out there no matter what the weather is calling for. Lord, please watch over them and protect them in the work that they do. Lord, we pray for the snowplow drivers who have been hard at work keeping our roads clear and clean. Keep them safe. Keep them alert as they work long hours. Lord, today we pray for Kathy Tangen, who is continuing to recover. Lord, that you would continue to guide and watch over her recovery. We pray for Gracie, who is recovering from RSV. We also pray for Jody, who's recovering after a reaction to an infusion. And we give thanks for last night's affirmation of faith for our high schoolers. Lord, we give thanks for how your spirit is at work in their life, changing them, transforming them, and bringing them into the fullness of life in the family of Christ. Lord, we know that there are many others who are sick in mind, body, and spirit. Lord, we pray your healing hand on them. We pray for those who are without jobs right now, Lord, that you would bring them peace and provision and those divine connections to bring that next job. We pray for those who are grieving the loss of a loved one. Lord, that your Holy Spirit would bring them comfort in this time of grieving. And Lord, lastly, we just take a quiet moment here to lay down any other burdens that are on our heart today, those deep, private things that we can share just with you personally. Thank you, Lord, for this time. Thank you, Lord, for being just such a kind and caring God who hasn't left us here to worry and to wander in this world, but a God who walks with us. Lord, help us every day to walk more and more closer with you, just to live into the fullness of life that you offer us through Jesus Christ. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Andrea. Just want to close our time together. Thank you for watching. Really not exactly how we love doing church. It is good to be with one another and shaking hands and hugging and just connecting that way. But today, with the weather the way it is, this is going to have to do. It'll make getting together next weekend all that more sweet. Part of our closing together is to be able to give an offering as we gather. If you find this helpful, and that you didn't have to travel through, if you find this Bible teaching is encouraging to you, if you find the church body of Resurrection to be uplifting and a part of a mission that you love to support and to grab onto and to serve with, please give your offerings this week. Kind of tacky, if you just want to text any dollar amount to 84321, you can put in, you know, $10, $50, $100, whatever you often would give to 84321, or there are some links coming through on the comments to be able to get onto our website and do giving, set up a regular giving account. If you haven't done it, this would be a great day to spend a little time putting that together. But we'd like to receive the offerings now, if you can make those offerings. If that just seems way too much, we're going to gather next week. And so bring what you had set aside for this week with next week's offering. That would be great as well. Just a couple of announcements before we go for the day. The summer gala is coming up March 9th. You want to get tickets online, go to our website for that. Kids are going to be sharing their testimonies about how God moves in their lives on these mission trips and high adventure and camp. We listened to the faith testimonies last night from our 9th, 10th, 11th graders. Almost all of them said how important camp was, how important high adventure and mission trips had been in their faith formation. So we certainly want to continue to support their going on these trips. The new devotionals are out. Your devotional is going to run out at the end of the week. So stop in at the church during the week. We're there Monday through Thursday from 9 to 5. Stop in and grab a devotional from the front desk. If you have friends or family that you hand them out to, we have plenty. So get those to family and friends as well. Financial Peace starts this week, Sunday night. You want to be there for that. Invite a friend. The signups are online as well. We have a link to the Financial Peace University site, helping you get money figured out in your family. One of the hardest things for married families is finances. Go ahead and it'd be just as good as marriage counseling, I'd say, sometimes. So check that out. And then finally, my last announcement is about an interim pastor. The council has been interviewing with a pastor over the last couple of weeks, and we got together as a council and call committee and listened and prayed and interviewed and talked and extended a call to Pastor Mark Markshausen. Pastor Mark is a integral part of the Via de Cristo community and has been connected to Resurrection that way. You actually, if you've been at church in January and February, the third week each month, I had asked Mark back in December if he would just come and help with some pulpit supply and to preach for us. In that process, we got into a conversation about the possibility of him coming and sticking around a little bit longer. So Pastor Mark Markshausen is going to join us this this next week he gets started, and I would guess we've talked to him about being around for a year to 18 months, whatever it takes for us to call a new interim pastor or a new long-term pastor. So he's going to be in the interim until we have someone full-time. So get to know him, connect with him. He's a fantastic guy. Love to hear him preach. I love to see him lead, and excited to have him with us. So Pastor Mark Markshausen, a great big hello and hi to you. I know you are watching on Facebook Live today anyway. So I'll be excited to see you this week at the church building, and good to celebrate and worship with the whole congregation next Sunday as you come on board. God bless you all. Let me send you with a benediction. The Lord blesses you and keeps you. The Lord's face shines upon you and is gracious to you. The Lord looks upon you with his favor and he gives you his peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hey, enjoy the weather out there. Cuddle up next to a fire. Have a cup of coffee. We love you. We'll see you next week. Bye-bye.